رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله
Allah our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them Allah our God is the greatest The one and only glory to him He born in humans to be the best And give his best religion to them
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim All praise due to Allah We praise him and we seek his help Whomsoever Allah guides is the truly guided one And whomsoever Allah leaves astray, none can show him guidance. My dear brothers and sisters, welcome to another edition of our program, Guardians of the Pious. Today's episode is number 325. And we'll continue talking about the obligation of fulfilling one's promise and pledges. In the previous episode and in Hadith 688, we discussed the Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam pointing to three evil traits saying that these are the traits of hypocrisy and in today's hadith the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be discussing four traits the three old traits of nifaq in addition to another one which is al-fujru fil khusuma exceeding the limit or being very extreme in your opposition and hatred to others which indicates that these three traits or four traits are not all the traits of the hypocrite and the traits of hypocrisy. Rather, these are the very prominent traits. So in this hadith, which is narrated by Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, which is agreed upon its authenticity, he said, أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالْ أَرْبَعٌ من كن فيه كان منافقا خالصا ومن كانت فيه خصلة منهن كانت فيه خصلة من النفاق حتى يدعها إذا اؤتمن خان وإذا حدث كذب وإذا عاهد غدر وإذا خاصم فجر In this hadith, the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, There are four traits that whoever have them, then he is a hypocrite. And whoever has one of these traits, then he has one of the attributes of hypocrisy until he leaves it. Then he mentioned the four traits. The first one is whenever he is entrusted, he betrays the trust. And whenever he speaks, he lies. And whenever he gives a promise, he betrays and he breaks his promise. وَإِذَا خَاصَمَ فَجَرَ And whenever he is in conflict with somebody, he exceeds the limit. He is very extremist in his opposition and in his hatred. And soon, inshallah, we will learn the meaning of وَإِذَا خَاصَمَ فَجَرَ lest we be amongst them. May Allah protect us. Of course, again, is that. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says those traits are enough, if a person have all of them, are enough to make him labeled as a munafiq, to be a hypocrite. Constantly lying, constantly breaking his promise, constantly betraying whenever he is entrusted with an amana, and إِذَا خَاصَمَ فَجَرَ The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in one of the ahadith which I love and appreciate most, أحبب حبيبك هونا ما فعسى أن يكون بغيضك يوما ما وأبغض بغيضك هونا ما فعسى أن يكون حبيبك يوما ما Very beautiful hadith regulates the social relationship. Whenever you love, be moderate in your love. Don't be very extreme in your love. Don't make love blind you and make you deaf. Be moderate. In case that your most beloved, the person, whether it's he or she whom you love most, and you're willing to give your life as a sacrifice for theirs, one day becomes your enemy. Is it possible for a person who loves somebody so much that one day it may happen that you hate him or you hate her? It's not only possible, it happens all the time. If you see, if you visit a lawyer and if you speak to a judge, I have a lot of friends who are judges, district attorneys, and so on. When you hear them and you hear about the cases, how a couple are filing cases against each other, it makes you think, subhanAllah, how is it possible? The couple who are most loving, who shared bed together, who had an intimate relationship with one another one day, who fought against the whole world in order to get married and be united, how can one day they turn to be very bad enemies to each other? This is life. This is life, and this is how it is. It is a reality. And on the other flip, is it possible to see two people who hated each other so much, picked on each other, mocked at each other, that one day they reconcile and they become not only friends, very close friends? It is possible. Because of that, the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, ordered moderation in love and in hate. You never know one day that the person whom you hate and he or she hates you, maybe you work out something together. Maybe you become very close friends. Maybe that you end up getting married, loving each other. It happens because this is qalb. Qalb, because it keeps changing, flipping over. The word qalb, they say, ما سمي القلب قلبا إلا لتقلبه. It was given that name in Arabic, qalb, because it is similar to al-qidri إذا اجتمعت غليان. The boiling pot, the water keeps flipping over. The bottom becomes on top, and the top becomes on the bottom. That's called the boiling point. For the water, it is the 100 degree. So it keeps flipping over. Qalb, that's qalb, that is the heart. It keeps changing, okay? You can never guarantee that it will remain in the same condition forever. And that's why we keep asking Allah for confirmation of our iman and to be steadfast on the straight path, out of fear that we may deviate, we may slip away, our heart may change. It happens. Even in our relationship with our Creator, with our Maker. But in our relationship with people whom we love, it's really bitter. And it leaves a very bitter taste when we turn to be enemies to those whom we loved one day, or they become our enemies. And it gets worse when the person becomes not only an opponent and they cut ties with those whom one day they were friends or family members or spouses, rather they become enemies. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا يحل لمؤمن أن يهجر أخاه فوق ثلاث. It is not permissible for a believer to boycott his brother or her sister for more than 3 days. Oh, Prophet of Allah, you don't know what she did to me. Oh, you have no idea what he did to me. And obviously the person will try to project all the evil things that he used to see, she used to be fully aware of, but because they were loving, they overlooked it. Now they throw the book at him or at her. Everything is displayed. The worst case scenario is when there are private relationships and secrets that this person one day, when he or she was your friend, your spouse, or your close friend, and trusted you with, no one else knows about it, and you start disclosing them. Why? Because now you hate him. you hate her. So you start talking about their private relationship, private life, and disclose all the secrets. This is a sign of nifaq. ومن الناس من يعجبك قوله في الحياة الدنيا ويشهد الله على ما في قلبه وهو ألد الخصام. That's alluded في الخصومة, which means that he is the worst enemy. Becomes very extreme in his or her animosity. This is a quality of hypocrisy. This is a quality and a trait, an evil trait of nifaq. والعياذ بالله. One should abandon it. So the Prophet ﷺ said, it may happen that you differ with somebody even though this person one day was very close to you. What shall you do? يُعْرِضُ هَذَا وَيُعْرِضُ هَذَا. You turn away from him or her, and you turn away from him or her even when you meet each other. Wallahi, some cases, brothers, blood brothers, live in the same building, and downstairs there is a masjid, a musalla, where people who are living in the neighborhood come to pray 5 times a day. So the brothers who live on top of each other in the same building, practicing, they pray the 5 daily prayers. Both of them have common friends. They pray, they chat with their friends, but they don't talk to each other. Blood brothers. And guess what? The Prophet ﷺ said, on Thursdays, on every Thursday, when the deeds are being presented before Allah the Almighty and people will be forgiven, all the believers, except somebody who associates partners to Allah in worship, and a mushahin, and somebody else who have severed his relationship with his brother or with her sister. So Allah the Almighty will say, أرجئ هذين حتى يصطلحا. Don't grant them this honor, forgiveness, or accepting their deeds, not until they reconcile. So this is the ultimatum here. If you maintain severing your relationship with people who are close to you, with your brothers, with your sisters, you are risking your deeds not to be accepted. You are so stubborn that you are not interested in Allah's forgiveness. But how would I take the initiative? How would I do it? Number one, as I said, the ultimatum, Allah Almighty says, أَرْجِئُ هَذَيْنِ حَتَّى يَصْطَلِحَا. Postpone the case of these two. Don't give them any of the privileges, not until they reconcile. And if they do, okay. Give them the reward, forgive them their sins, accept their deeds. How shall I do it? The Prophet ﷺ said, يُعْرِضُ هَذَا وَيُعْرِضُ هَذَا وَخَيْرُهُمَا مَنْ يَبْدَأُ بِالسَّلَامِ. And the best of the two opponents is the one who would have the courage, have the guts, takes the initiative and goes to the other person, whether he's at fault or the other person is at fault, and he will stretch out his hand to him or to her and say, Assalamu alaikum, forgive me. Break the ice, destroy the ice block, kill Satan. Shoot him in the brains. By doing so, yes, it will make Satan upset most because you reconcile. I say, we don't have to resume the entire relationship like his family would come and visit my family and same old will happen, because maybe the reason I'm boycotting him or her because, you know, his family members do things that ruin my family, so it's better to keep the relationship official. But when we meet each other, Assalamu alaikum, we greet each other, we check on each other. حق المسلم على المسلم, fulfill the rights of a Muslim upon another Muslim, that whenever he sneezes, you say, يرحمكم الله, if he says Alhamdulillah. Whenever he gets sick, you visit him. If he has a funeral, you attend the funeral and you extend the condolence to him. Whenever you see him, you greet him with the greeting of Assalam. You include him or her in your dua. Okay, every now and then pay them a visit. It doesn't have to be very close, but make certain that you broke the ice and you reconciled. Totally the opposite of all of these beautiful teachings, what is known as al-fujru fil khusuma. Not only that, you reveal the secret of your opponents, which he entrusted you with one day, but furthermore, you make up stories. You talk ill about them, and your heart is full of hatred and jealousy and hasad to the extent that you cannot tolerate hearing his or her name. Every time their name is mentioned, or if it is not mentioned, you make mention of their name in public, in other gathering, in order to discredit them. Even talk ill about them, about things which are not facts. Take any advantage of any situation in order to discredit them. That's called al-fujru fil khusuma. And this is only a sign of the munafiqeen. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, the head of the hypocrites, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam honored him, respected him, and treated him as a chieftain. He gave him his position. But whenever he had a chance to nail Muslims, he would not hesitate to do it. Even to hurt the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his honor, he would do it. Once he said, and that is stated in the Quran, لَإِنْ رَجَعْنَا إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ لَيُخْرِجَنَّ الْأَعَزُّ مِنْهَا الْأَذَلُّ. So Allah recorded that in the Quran. There was a young boy by the name Zayd ibn Arqam. He heard this private conversation. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul was talking with some of his followers of the Munafiqeen. They were returning from one of the expeditions. And he said that when we go back to Al-Madinah, the honorable ones shall prevent the disgraced and the humiliated ones from entering Medina. We shall kick them out. By that, he was plotting and talking against whom? Against Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who honored them, and against Muslims, against the immigrants. When Zayd ibn Arqam went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and shared with him what he heard, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul denied. He said, he's a young boy. I swear to God, I've never said anything like that. وهو ألد الخصام وهو ألد الخصام, he's the worst of opponents, subhanallah. So Allah the Almighty revealed and disclosed his evil intention and what he said in public, and he confirmed the statement of this young boy that he have heard it right, and this munafiq have said so. So now he is disclosed before all people that he's a munafiq. Yet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not mistreat him, did not label him with the nifaq. He treated him according to the obvious way that he displayed before people. He pretended to be Muslim, so he treated him as a Muslim. Not once he told him that you're a munafiq. Furthermore, he even spread the rumor, the slander against the mother of the believers, Aisha radiallahu anha. Then he slipped away. So he created the trouble and he slipped away, like Satan exactly. That's called fujrun fil khusuma, and that's why it is one of the traits of the munafiqeen. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the hadith, man kunna fihi kana munafiqan khalisa, whoever possesses these four traits, he is a pure hypocrite. And whoever have any of these evil traits, then he's got one of the traits of hypocrisy until he abandons it and he gives it up. Is it possible for a Muslim and a practicing Muslim to have some of these evil traits? It is possible. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, may Allah be pleased with him, Inna kamru'un fika jahiliya. Don't misunderstand me. Abu Dharr al-Ghifari was a great companion. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed for him many times. May Allah have mercy on Abu Dharr. He lives by himself, he walks by himself, and he dies by himself. He's a nation by himself. And once he said to him, O Abu Dharr, I love for you exactly what I love for myself, the same as I love for myself. What else could be better than that? Yet when Abu Dharr al-Ghifari was involved in an evil practice, is it evil? It is evil. And how could he be involved in an evil practice or indulge in such sin? Well, he's a human being. He's not infallible. When he had an argument with Bilal ibn Rabah and he insulted him, saying that You know, he insulted him because of his skin complexion, black. As a result of that, Bilal complained to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam woke up Abu Dharr and he shook him hard and he said, "You're a man who maintains some of the traits of ignorance." What did Abu Dharr do? Abu Dharr al-Ghifari went to Bilal and he threw himself on the floor. He put his face on the ground and he begged Bilal to forgive him and to show that he really forgave him by stepping on his face. You know, it was a slip of my tongue. So Abu Dharr was not one of those who were extreme in their opposition or hatred. No, rather, كان رجعاً. Once he was reminded, he was reminded and he repented. So we want to be like Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, even if you have any of the traits of jahiliyyah or any of the traits of nifaq, which is possible, to try to eliminate them, try to overcome them, try to diagnose your own evil trait and eliminate it. And that can be achieved, by the way, brothers and sisters, by having a sincere friend, very close friend. You take him like a mirror. Mirrors do not lie. When you look in the mirror, you hold the comb and the makeup, you know where you need to fix, right? Mirrors do not complement. They only reflect the images, the reality. So when you have a true friend who would not hesitate to tell you in your face, hey, you did something wrong. You were very harsh when you were talking to this person or that person. You should appreciate that. You should take this advice and try to work on yourself, to eliminate this evil trait, to improve something which is weak in yourself, to maintain something which is a good quality. Sometimes the Prophet ﷺ said to some of his companions, you have good qualities, okay? You knew that, you need to maintain them. You need to grow them within yourself and so on. For those who may have any of these evil traits of hypocrisy, it doesn't mean that they are pure hypocrites, but they need to eliminate them in order to return back on the straight path. We'll take a short break, and inshallah, in a few minutes, we'll come back to continue with another beautiful hadith. Please stay tuned.
رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته, and welcome back. The following hadith in this beautiful chapter, The Obligation of Fulfilling the Promises and Pledges, is hadith number 690. It's a hadith that is narrated by the great companion Jabir ibn Abdullah, may Allah be pleased with him and his father. He said, قال لي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لو قد جاء مال البحرين أعطيتك هكذا وهكذا وهكذا فلم يجئ مال البحرين حتى قبض النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فلما جاء مال البحرين أمر أبو بكر رضي الله عنه فنادى من كان له عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عدة أو دين فليأتنا فأتيته وقلت له إن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لي كذا وكذا فحث لي حثية فعددتها فإذا هي 500 فقال لي خذ مثليها متفق عليه. This hadith, which is agreed upon its authenticity, Jabir ibn Abdullah, may Allah be pleased with him and his father. His father was martyred on the Battle of Uhud. He narrated that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, told me, when the revenues of Bahrain will arrive, I shall give you such and such and such. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed away before the revenues of Bahrain were received. When the revenues came during the Khilafat of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, may Allah be pleased with him, he announced, anyone whom the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, promised or owed anything should come to him, يعني come to Abu Bakr in order to pay him the ida, the promise, or الدين, the debt. Jabir ibn Abdullah رضي الله عنهما said, I went to him and I said that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, had said to me such and such. So Abu Bakr took a double handful out of the money and gave it to me. I counted it and I found that it was 500 dirhams. Then Abu Bakr al-Siddiq رضي الله عنه said to me, take twice as much more of the amount. The hadith is collected by both Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim. May Allah have mercy on them. It is very obvious from the hadith that the hadith was chosen perfectly right to suit the topic of the chapter, which is the obligation of fulfilling the promise and the pledge. And here, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had given a promise, it's a conditioned promise, to one of his companions, Jabir ibn Abdullah radiyallahu anhum. He said, if we receive the revenues of the jizya from Bahrain, then I shall give you hakada wa hakada wa hakada, so much. He didn't mention a specific amount. During the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the revenues of Bahrain never came. When Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu became the caliph, this is the ideal city, the ideal community where the successor, the caliph, fulfills the promises of his predecessor. Not the opposite. Nowadays, whenever a president is elected or a king is appointed, he casts all the blame on the previous one. Even nowadays in the United States, okay, they brag about their democracy and freedom. So the elect president is casting all the blame of, you know, the unemployment, the health plan, the insufficiency in fund here and there, and in all the policies, he says it was all messed up because of the former president. In our case, the caliph, which means a successor, doesn't start from the scratch. He resumed what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have started. He follows his guidance, and that's why he declared, in case that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, have given anyone ida, al-ida here from al-wa'd, which means he promised him. So it was mere voluntary charity or gift, or dayn, or anyone whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam owed any money shall come to us, and I shall pay him off whatever the Messenger of Allah had promised him or owed him. So amongst those who showed up, Jabir ibn Abdullah. Jabir ibn Abdullah is a trustworthy companion and have been admired by the Messenger of Allah and narrated many a hadith. And perhaps Abu Bakr al-Siddiq was an eyewitness himself. So that's why when he came and he said, well, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam promised me to give me. So it wasn't a debt. It was something bonus, a gift, extra. And he said, hakada wa hakada wa hakada, so much and so much. He said, okay, so double handful, a handful is like that. That's, you know, when you fill your hand, mud. Half mud is a handful. And mud is when both hands, the double handful of money. Currency in the past was in banknotes or papers. It was rather gold or silver. The dirham was made of silver, and the dinar was made of gold. So when Abu Bakr al-Siddiq filled his hands, a handful of money, and he gave it to Jabir ibn Abdullah, may Allah be pleased with him, he counted them. He said, count them. So he estimated them 500 dirham. He said, take twice as much. So hakada, wa hakada, wa hakada. Three hathiyat, three handful. So the first one was 500, then take twice, So the total number will be 1500. This is amazing. How the successors made certain to fulfill the promises, even though it was a gift. And the Prophet ﷺ said, لو قد جاء مال البحرين. If the revenues of Bahrain will come, I shall give you so much. But it didn't come. So he doesn't have any commitment. He doesn't owe him anything. It rather came during the Khilafah of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. But Abu Bakr was so loyal that he wanted to fulfill even a promise that the Prophet ﷺ have given to anyone. So the hadith is an indication that it is very important to fulfill the promises and pledges. That was the last hadith in chapter number 86, the obligation of fulfilling the promises and pledges. And now we shall begin with another beautiful chapter under the book, the Kitab of Al-Adab, the Etiquette. Chapter number 87 deals with Al-Muhafadha ala ma'atadahu min al-khayr. The importance of maintaining the good deeds that you used to do. Sometimes the person starts doing something which is good. Then he relapses, or he slows down, or he goes back on his heels, or he is distracted for a reason or another. I'm talking about if he does that deliberately. Because if the person used to do a good deed, then something out of his control interrupted his continuous observance of the good deeds, then he still gets the same reward. It is promised in the hadith that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, إِذَا مَرِضَ الْعَبْدُ أَوْ سَافَرْ كُتِبَ لَهُ مَا كَانَ يَفْعَلُهُ حَالَ إِقَامَتِهِ وَصِحَّتِهِ. In case that a person used to do any good deed which requires him to be settled at home, present, resident, not a musafir, but now he is traveling, so he cannot do it, he still gets the same reward. If the person used to do anything which was linked to his strength and his health, but because now he is sick and he is unable to do it anymore, he still gets the same reward. The example of the first case is fasting. A person who is used to fast on Mondays and Thursdays, but because he's traveling, and voluntary fasting while traveling during the journey is not recommended, and it's a tough journey, long journey, so he is not fasting anymore, and he is using the concession in this case. لَيْسَ مِنْ بِرٍ صِيَامٍ فِمْ سَفَرٍ. Even though he is not fasting, but because he used to fast while he was resident, and now because he's traveling and he's busy with the journey, he's not fasting, yet he's getting the same reward. The example of the second, again sickness, with the same ibadah. He used to fast, now the doctor said, you're diagnosed with diabetes, and you can fast at least in this stage. So he's not fasting at all, and he's getting the reward of fasting, all the voluntary fasting that he used to do. If he used to fast every other day, he's getting the reward of fasting on every other day. But there are some ibadat will not be affected by traveling, a charity. He gives in a charity. You don't have to be resident or traveling. You know, in any condition, as long as you're wealthy enough, you can give. He used to give, but now the business slowed down. He cannot even afford to spend on his family. So his financial assistance to others, to schools, to orphanages, to hospitals, have been seized. But the reward has not been seized. Why? Because it was interrupted due to a cause out of his control. And this is a mercy of Allah and a vast generosity from him. That even though the condition have changed, but Allah does not deprive you from the reward simply because of the habit. It used to be. You used to do it on a regular basis. So you still get the same reward. In this chapter, Imam Nawawi, may Allah have mercy on him, began with ayah number 11, chapter number 13, Surah Ar-Ra'd. In this ayah, Allah the Almighty says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ, which means certainly Allah doesn't change the conditions of any people unless they change themselves. In most cases, people actually, choose this ayah to support another meaning, even though the other meaning is also considered and is also right, but the real meaning of this ayah for which it was revealed, يعني, if Allah the Almighty blessed anyone with any blessing, as long as the person is fulfilling his duties towards Allah and doing whatever good deeds he is doing, Allah the Almighty will maintain his ni'mah and his blessing and the good condition that the person is experiencing. But if the person were to change, then in this case, Allah the Almighty may change. It's like a reminder of the person. Look, you are in a good condition because of the good that you are doing. Because you've changed, now we are experiencing maybe some lack of provision, maybe some afflictions, maybe some health problems, for whatever reason. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ لَيُحْرَمُ الرِّزْقَ بِالذَّنْبِ يُصِيبُ. The person may actually be deprived from his provision, which he used to get on a regular basis, because of a sin that he has committed. Oh, people would object to that, or some people would say, Sheikh, but the non-Muslims are prospering more than Muslims, and they're living a very luxurious life, and they're not committing any kind of sin, they're committing shirk, or they don't believe in God to begin with. I couldn't but agree. You just need to realize that twice in the Quran, in Surah Al-A'raf, ayah number 183, and also in Surah Al-Qalam, ayah number 45, Allah the Almighty said, وَأُمْلِي لَهُمْ إِنَّ كَيْدِي مَتِينَ, which means that when Allah the Almighty extends the provision and the good condition to people who are committing the sins on constant basis, this is not a sign, this is not a sign of approval. This is not a sign of happiness and pleasure. Rather, this is a plan of withdrawing the people into their terrible fate. Only lahum, give them a respite. And don't rush, you're going to see soon their terrible end. This is not a sign of approval that Allah the Almighty is given, but they are not even grateful to any of these givings. That's a terrible sign. If a person, even if a Muslim, thinks that even though I'm not praying, even though I'm not giving my zakah, but my companies are growing bigger and my business is successful, this is not a sign. This is not a good sign. On the contrary, it's a sign that soon you will be afflicted with a big shock. With it, you will not be able to recover. وَأُمْلِي لَهُمْ, give them a respite. Okay, give them another chance. إِنَّ كَيْدِي مَتِينَ, indeed, my plan is perfect. As I said, that was mentioned twice in the Quran. But sometimes Allah the Almighty, whenever loving His servant, if He sees him, slow down on something good that he used to do, He would give him a little reminder. So he will go back and he will resume doing what is good. So in order to maintain the ni'am and the blessings, maintain the good deeds that you're doing. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. In Surah Saba, Allah the Almighty talked about the people of Saba. فَبَدَّلْنَاهُمْ بِجَنَّتَيْهِمْ جَنَّتَيْنِ ذَوَاتَيْ أُكُلٍ خَمْطٍ وَأَثْلٍ وَشَيْءٍ مِّن سِدْرٍ. Each word of this ayah needs an explanation. The people of Saba used to live a happy life, and they used to have a big dam that was built by Bilqais. Okay. And for some reason, when they rejected the truth and they disbelieved in Allah, Allah the Almighty sent against them Sayl al-Arim, a very big flood. So when they turn away and they rejected the truth, فَأَعْرَضُوا, they rejected the truth. أَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَيْلَ الْعَرِمِ, a very big flood which passed and destroyed their dam, which was known as the dam of Al-Arim. And Allah the Almighty exchanged the luxurious life that they used to have and all the fruits, because in the previous ayah, ayah number 15, Allah the Almighty said, look, Saba used to have two gardens, two huge gardens to the right and to the left. It used to produce all kinds of fruits and vegetables. Just eat and be grateful to your Lord. But when they rejected faith and the truth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deprived them out of all of that. And instead, He exchanged the good fruits and the palatable food with terrible trees and very little provision. ذَلِكَ جَزَيْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَفَرُوا وَهَلْ نُجَازِي إِلَّا الْكَفُورُ. So this is a recompense for them. We recompense them as means of punishment for their disbelief. And Allah doesn't give such recompense but to the ungrateful ones. I hope this ayah is clear in the light of إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُوا Maybe anfusim. What is the other meaning that normally speakers, preachers, and teachers use this ayah to support? It is when people are living in a terrible condition. And they say, we have been praying, we have been asking Allah, but there is no change. So the preachers, the shuyukh would say, look, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. You want to change? You want Allah to change your condition? You got to be willing to change. Surely Allah doesn't change the conditions of people unless they change themselves. You have to be willing to change. You have to change yourselves. You have to be honest. You have to be sincere. You have to be good people. You have to show truly that you're willing to change. But as long as you're not willing to change, change will not take place. This happens to the communities which are experiencing terrible oppression, experiencing terrible economical conditions. Look, what kind of mess up that you have in your relationship with your Creator. Once you fix it, once you show willingness to change, then Allah the Almighty will change your condition. That is the other meaning, which is also right to use this ayah in reference to this meaning. The following verse is of ayah number 92, Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, in which Allah the Almighty says, وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّتِي نَقَضَتْ غَزْلَهَا مِنْ بَعْدِ قُوَّةٍ أَنْكَاثًا تَتَّخِذُونَ أَيْمَانَكُمْ دَخَلًا بَيْنَكُمْ. What is the meaning of وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّتِي نَقَضَتْ غزلها من بعد قوة أنكاثا. It means, don't you be like the woman who undoes the thread which he has spun after it has become strong. Subhanallah, imagine a woman who spends a whole day spinning the wool in order to make a nice fabric, a nice garment. And after she's done it perfectly, all of a sudden she will undo the thread which she has spun all day by holding the end of the thread and pulling it away. She will undo the thread which she has spun. Why do you do that? If anyone were to see that, would say this is foolish. But there are a lot of people who do that. After Allah the Almighty shows them the right path, they taste the sweetness of repentance and they start practicing and they are doing perfect with regards to the relationship with Allah, on the level of commitment with their family members, with work. They are living a very fine life. All of a sudden they change. They slow down or they change. Then what happens is As a result, it would be like the woman who undid whatever she have spun. All the work that you've done will be simply wasted and will be ruined. Examples to that. When the person was very keen to control what his family are watching, because nowadays with a simple remote control you can watch everything from movies, series, jokes to porno. Then his family were doing fine, his kids were disciplined, and he would get up at Fajr and he would wake up his family members, let's pray Jama'ah or go to the masjid and pray. Then all of a sudden, maybe he will travel abroad. He will see a different life. And he will come back and say, why did I put my kids in prison? This is a very stiff life. We're very strict. We want to live like the rest of people. It can go as bad as to completely change in faith. Subhanallah. Yesterday I was watching a clip. Somebody whom Allah blessed or tested with plenty of wealth. So he is a multi-billionaire. A Muslim person has plenty of businesses, a lot of money. You can count it. Then he's saying, I don't mind if people want to drink, then let them drink. If people want to have a boyfriend and a girlfriend, as long as they're happy, let everyone enjoy their lives. Really? Is it all about that? Is this what your religion has been teaching you? Is this what Allah the Almighty has bestowed upon you or tested you with wealth, won it from you? It only was said as a result of being very wealthy to the point that you forgot the main purpose that you were created for. You need to repent. You need to go back quickly and don't be like this woman who wasted all her work, maybe a day work, a week work, a whole month of work. Some people waste a whole life of work by relapsing, by going back on their heels, by changing. I've seen some sisters after wearing niqab or hijab for years. Now they wear mini skirts. They think, now I was wasting my time. Now I'm living a free life. It's what you're going to pay for. So this is again a reminder that maintain the good that you're doing, even if it is a little, until you die in a safe condition. And that basically was the most frequently recited dua by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Oh Allah, the one who changes the hearts, keep my heart firm on your deen. Brothers and sisters, we ran out of time, and to be continued inshallah in the next episode. Until then, I leave you all in the care of Allah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
رسول الله حبيب الله الله our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them Allah our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise. Worshipping cows, fire and stones. Selling the best with the cheapest price.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise. Worshipping cows, fire and stones. Selling their best with the cheapest price.